The southern outskirts of the Afghan capital, Kabul. The major exit and entry routes to the city are all blocked to stop insurgents and drug smugglers. Beyond here, government rule ends. A handful of Afghan counter-narcotics police are trying to stem the flow of opium and heroin that last year accounted for 93% of the world's heroin production. But their efforts amount to little more than a speed bump on the heroin highway. The officers are trained by the international counter-narcotics effort, led by the United States. This campaign against the opium and heroin industry in Afghanistan has already cost the US more than $500 million. But it's clear even that level of investment isn't stopping the drug trade.
Illicit drug production undermines rule of law. It fuels corruption. It discourages private investment. It undermines governance. It creates violence and instability. When the drug traffickers and the Taliban are collaborating, they collaborate effectively. But when they're actually just working independently, they're both going after the same aims, which is to weaken the government, to weaken the society, to weaken democracy, to weaken rule of law, to foment violence, to foment instability. They're working against all of the goals that the United States and Australia are seeking with the government of President Karzai here in Afghanistan. That's the problem.
This is the main road from Kabul to the city of Jalalabad in Nangarhar province on the way to Pakistan. Until recently, this was the heart of the opium industry. Both sides of the road would have been lined with opium poppies. But at least here, things have changed. This local TV footage shows the destruction of a small field of last year's opium crop in Nangarhar. The locals watch as their livelihood is destroyed. Now they have no income and they are still in debt to opium smugglers who advance their money to pay for the crop. And they say compensation promised by America, fertilizer and seed for alternative crops, has simply not been delivered.
From the government, they've made a lot of promises.
The aid programs have not filtered through to the people who need them. Why do you think that is, do you think?
I've heard the comment. It's a comment that one hears frequently. But I'm not sure it's an accurate comment. Nangarhar has received lots of assistance. Some of it has been security assistance, but most of it has been economic, developmental, humanitarian, health, education, things like that.
What we're seeing is a very short-term, extremely short-term view of saying to the farmers, don't plant poppies, when you have not dealt with any of the knock-on effects of them not planting from their point of view.
Noreen McDonald is working in Afghanistan on a project to bolster a world shortage of morphine. But her efforts have been frustrated by America's blanket opposition to opium production here.
The farmers throughout Afghanistan have used opium as a way to get credit to get them through the winter. So if you have a planted opium crop, the local shopkeepers will advance you credit to get through the hard winter months.
McDonald believes the whole US approach to drugs has been a failure.
Well, it seems that they have a real fixed mindset about counter-narcotics policy, which, if you want to shorthand that, that's the US war on drugs mindset, and they pursued that in Latin America.
Ambassador Wood's previous posting was Colombia, where he earned the nickname of Chemical Bill for his campaign of aerial spraying of coca crops, a practice which resulted in lawsuits by local farmers brought against US government hired contractors. He's been criticised for promoting the same eradication policy in Afghanistan.
You've been a proponent of aerial spraying. What's happening with that program?
I don't think I would say I've been a proponent of aerial eradication. I've been a proponent of effective eradication. 16 eradicators were killed by drug traffickers last year. We've already lost two this year. Aerial eradication covers more area faster and safer. But if the people won't support it, if there isn't a consensus in favor of it, then it's not appropriate.
Do you think eradication, basically wiping out the narcotics industry in this country, is possible with the current government?
I certainly do.
You do?
I think that President Karzai is overwhelmingly the most popular political leader in Afghanistan. I think that his government is working hard. I think that his government, in partnership with the international community, is delivering a better life and more security to many, many Afghans. I think that they are very clear about the threat that drugs represent.
Do you think the government itself is influenced by warlords and those making money out of the opium trade?
Yes, but he cannot change it.
Yeah.
It's why, because they are strong, they are inside the government, and I have a fear, if the situation continues like this, the future government of Afghanistan will be a narco-terrorist state in Afghanistan that nobody, even international community, would not be able to control it.
The solution, according to Ministry of Counter-Narcotics spokesman Zalmay Afzali, is more money, and lots of it.
So what I'm asking is, on the part of the Afghan government, is that we do need similar kind of projects, and we do need a very huge amount of money to fight this this evil and this evil mafia.
He says that the drug traffickers are simply too strong for the Afghan government.
And we do need a lot of help. We need capacity-wise help. We need assistance in terms of equipping the police, giving them training, providing them latest technology. Like I had said before, you know, with three bullets of AK-47 and somebody's wearing a sandal and standing in the desert in between the border of Iran and Afghanistan, and you expect them to stop an international mafia.
At the bombed-out shell of the Soviet Cultural Center in Kabul, I find these men smoking heroin. Drug addiction is as much a problem here as it is around the world. The addicts of Afghanistan now number more than a million, and efforts to stop their drug supply are adding a new complexity to an already highly volatile political landscape.
Those that are responsible for American counter-narcotics policy in Afghanistan are now becoming responsible for providing this fertile political ground for the return of the Taliban and the growth of the insurgency here.
And any increase in Taliban strength could mean more casualties for the 1,000 Australian troops now stationed in Afghanistan.
Okay, you want to take a photo of that?
The only solution, first of all, is to try internally and externally to bring peace in this country, security for this country. When there is a peace, the government must be a strong government, representative government, not introduced from the outside, not to become the members by relationship, but the government must be a professional government, a servants of the people, not ruling the people and looting the people.